Thank you very much, Professor Cassis. We will have you again this afternoon for your lecture on precautionary principle as international law and under Philippine practice. To give us the opening remarks is the program head, Knowledge Management Department of the Southeast Asian Regional Center for Graduate Study and Research in Agriculture, CIRCA for short. Ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Maria Celeste Cadiz.
Good morning to Professor Romel Cassis, OIC Director of the Institute of International Legal Studies. And we thank you for the partnership. We hope to have more meaningful engagement with lawyers in general and with your institute for agricultural issues. Mr. Luigi Tabios, our speaker this morning. Everyone, scientists, leaders in your own right, lawyers, communicators, good morning. First, as I look at the audience, I'm not sure if many of you know CIRCA, so let me just briefly introduce CIRCA as a very long name, but outside of the long name, its main mandate is capacity development and institutional strengthening in agricultural and rural development. With three mission areas, which are, and we are better known for giving graduate scholarships, graduate education, and institutional development of young universities in agriculture, research and development, and knowledge management. And that goes for the short introduction. As I reflected on this seminar for this morning, I note that last year was marked by the dawn of the ASEAN Economic Community, or AEC. But how many of us feel this and consider ourselves ASEAN, not just Filipinos? Whether we are mindful of AEC or not, it is going to affect our lives. And our country in particular needs to be prepared not just unwittingly be at the receiving end of its impacts, whatever these impacts may be. And in the ASEAN Economic Community, agriculture remains an engine of its economic growth. And this has been asserted by the ASEAN Secretariat and the backbone of food security in the region. At CIRCA, we believe that food security for the agricultural and rural sector, where the larger segment of the poor in ASEAN belong, may be addressed via inclusive agricultural enterprises that allow integration of medium and small-scale farming sectors into the regional and global market. These are among our overriding concerns within CIRCA's current 10th five-year plan, which is for the period 2014 to 2019, and we are in the middle of that plan. And that plan champions inclusive and sustainable agricultural and rural development, or what we call PSAR. Next month, just a short advertisement, CIRCA is celebrating its 50th anniversary. And in so doing, I had to reflect on the past to develop our exhibit. And proud to find that CIRCA was a leader in asserting agriculture and rural development and putting it in the agenda of institutions from its beginning. And it continues to strive to remain such. Well, today's seminar is important to us at CIRCA because, if I may quote Mr. Jack Bobo, Bobo, because he's American. Because you know what Bobo means. Mr. Jack Bobo is a trade policy advisor at the U.S. Department of State. He said, he noted that international agreements impact the ability of science and technology to enhance food security. If I may quote, international agreements, domestic laws, and regulations have the power to promote scientific research and the adoption of new technology through effective, efficient, and predictable science-based regulatory systems, or to impede development and adoption of new technology by miring it in burdensome or unnecessary regulations, he said. Mr. Bobo has articulated on what he calls as disparate impacts of international agreements on food security from the perspective of agricultural biotechnology, and concluded that agreements related to biosafety and sustainable development may have impacts beyond their stated objectives that can negatively impact efforts to achieve food security. By ensuring that a wider range of interests are considered in the development of these agreements, the final agreements will better reflect the economic and social realities of the parties. In a recent workshop we held at CIRCA, launching an IFAD project that promotes agricultural transformation, emphasizing market integration of small-scale producers, another leader, Mr. Shang Hee Tan, CEO of CropLife Asia, narrated how long a technology is developed and reaches the farmers. For instance, ketchup takes 3 years from development to delivering the product to those who are using it. A Boeing 787 plane takes 8 years. But crop protection and GM seeds take 11 to 13 years, while pharmaceuticals take 13 years as well. But Mr. Shang Hee Tan asserted that on the average, it actually takes up to 16.8 years to deliver such technology to the hands of ASEAN farmers because of their limited access to technology and obstacles in exports, while also because of this long lag, it encourages the proliferation of counterfeit crop protection products, which of course also poses a risk to the users. The obstacles in exports, he pointed out, include non-tariff trade barriers, largely shaped by highly restrictive regulatory systems that may be overly cautious without solid scientific basis. These are precisely why we hope this seminar will open up better understanding of the perspectives between scientists and researchers regarding the implications of such international agreements, domestic laws and regulations on our agricultural and rural development, redounding to our peoples, especially the poorest, food and nutrition security. And likewise, an understanding on the side of regulators and lawmakers or lawyers on the issues regarding technology development and the perspective also of the scientists. As Mr. Jack Bobo asked, how many lawyers does it take to feed a village? But if I may add, aside from the lawyers, how many lawyers, scientists, regulators, farmers, and industry take to feed a village? And his answer, all of them working together. May today be a fruitful exchange that leads to meaningful actions and decisions redounding to our food secure nation, especially for poor Filipinos. Good morning.